All right, so my name is Betsy Wasilevich, and I'm going to talk a little bit about health insurance membership and claims data. So in my professional career, I've had the great advantage of working with both Medicaid data and commercial claims data for one of the largest insurers in the state. And so I'm going to talk a little bit about what kind of data we have, what we do with it, and what its limitations are.
Okay.
There we go. So for those of you who are unfamiliar with claims data and membership data, this is the style of data that we have. For membership, we'll have demographic characteristics, geographical location for every time a member or beneficiary moves. We'll have enrollment information, how many months or days they're enrolled in the health insurance plan, and benefit structure. Our claims data have a few flavors: facility, professional claims, pharmacy claims, vision, and dental. And for each one of these types of claims, there's different styles of information. But for most of them, we do have diagnosis codes, procedure codes, places of service or where the service was rendered, and the rendering provider, practitioner, or prescriber. And we also have sort of resource information for providers in the state, whether that be a physician or a practitioner, their practice in which they belong, their physician organizations, and how they aggregate themselves across the state, and facilities, clinics, etc. So how payer data is most often used is starting with ongoing surveillance. This may be the frequency of persons with particular health conditions that is derived from a claims-based prevalence case definition through looking at healthcare utilization among those subsets of the population, frequency of inpatient visits, frequency of primary care visits, etc. We also use it for population health management. We'll evaluate gaps in care at a variety of different levels and work with physicians and providers across the state to close those gaps in care. I've been involved in several projects where the population is risk stratified so that we can target both public health and clinical interventions appropriately. Case management services are often one of these types of interventions where we will try to identify a population at greatest need. We'll also do predictive modeling to determine cost drivers. This definitely falls under the hat of the commercial payer for which I work. We're always interested in trying to understand what is going to be the cost driver for healthcare services. Another large part of what I do with the commercial payer is incentive payment determination, where we will evaluate physicians and practices and look for the high performers and incentivize them. This is often known as pay for performance. We also do clinical and public health program evaluation using the claims and membership data, and health services and even epidemiologic research using the claims data. But of course, there are several challenges and gaps in these data. First, we only see claims for billed services. So if a service was provided but we don't see the claim, then it doesn't exist to us. The timeliness of claims can prove to be a problem sometimes, less so in the commercial sector than in the public sector. Claims sometimes take a while to get to us before we can pay them. But probably the most important limitation of claims and membership data is missing information, practice characteristics, member characteristics, and the clinical information about the member or beneficiary, how severe their illness is, or specific health outcomes related to their illness. We'll know that a lab test was performed, but we can't tell you the level of the result of the lab test. There are some sort of gaps in what we can do from a standardized approach. We have difficulty validating metrics that we design or case definitions that we develop using claims data, surely because of lack of access to that clinical record. Continuous enrollment is often required for much of what we do. This can drastically affect the sample size that we're able to evaluate, but it also zeroes in on a population that's dissimilar from those who are not continuously enrolled. This you find especially in Medicaid. Those discontinuously enrolled folks are definitely a different type of population than those that are continuously enrolled. And even though it is big data, by the time we zero down into a population served by a particular physician or practice, we can have small numbers. And dealing with that missing information or small numbers statistically is a challenge. I already alluded to differences based on the source or type of the claim. Availability of this data can be also a challenge, especially for external researchers. Lack of multi-payer data systems. We can evaluate only the members we have and not the members that go to different health insurance plans. And there are data sharing hurdles, whether or not you're trying to access Medicaid data or commercial population data. And generalizability. Of course, these are members that belong to either the public or private sector plans and won't necessarily be generalizable to the rest of the population. And this is way too much to cover past my 5 minutes. I didn't hear that buzzer. So I'll just say that it is multidisciplinary, the work that we do, reaching out first and foremost to healthcare practitioners, but we also rely heavily on IT, medical informatics, and statistics and biostatistics to overcome some of those data issues that I alluded to.